Will the clerk please call the roll?
Barbara Brenner?
Here.
Sam Crawford?
Here.
Kathy Kershner?
Here.
Bill Knutzen?
Here.
Pete Kremen?
Here.
Ken Mann?
Here.
Carl Weimer?
Here.
All right, thank you, and will you all please stand and join me in saluting the flag? Thank you. Will everybody please check and make sure your cell phone is on silent? And I'll remind you that if you're going to hand anything out to the council, if you'll please give a copy to our clerk down here for the public record. All right. It looks like we've got an update. We had a committee of the whole meeting this afternoon. We had our consultant DLR group present a jail planning update. And estimated cost that we're looking at this point is $109 million to build our jail and sheriff's facilities. There are about 35% contingencies worked into that. We are at the very preliminary stages of planning for that, but stay tuned. We'll keep on seeing where we end up with this. All right, we also have minutes to approve. We've got regular county council for June 18th, 2013. Surface water work session for June 25th, 2013. Regular county council for July 9th, 2013. Special committee of the whole for July 23rd, 2013. Committee of the whole for July 23rd, 2013. Regular county council for July 23rd, 2013. Board of health for July 30th, 2013. Special committee of the whole for August 6th, 2013. And regular county council for August 6th, 2013. Is there a motion to approve?
Move approval.
Councilmember Knutzen moves to approve. Are there any changes to the minutes? All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And that passes 7-0. So tonight we have got two public hearings, and we'll get right into those. The first public hearing is a resolution approving the recommendations on applications for open space current use assessment. And we did get some additional information, and that is in your purple. That's got a purple cover sheet on it. And thank you. You came right up. I was going to say, is there a staff report? Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Erin Osborne, Whatcom County Planning and Development Services. I'm the staff person assigned to coordinate the...
Erin, can you pull the microphone right down to your mouth?
There you go. Erin Osborne, Whatcom County Planning Development Services. I'm the staff person assigned to the administration of the open space current use program. This year we had three applications, as you have reviewed in committee earlier this afternoon. One is the Sefton application, a transfer of land that's classified as farm and ag land into the open space land classification. Staff recommendation is approval on this application with a... public benefit rating of 71.75. It's been reviewed with a public benefit rating system. It offers a number of different public access amenities, such as a half mile loop trail and through wooded and pastured areas, and ample parking for large vehicles during posted hours and by appointment, and also offers nighttime sky viewing or astronomy viewing. The two other applications that have been received, I'm not sure if you would like to talk about the individual applications or consider them as a whole. Otherwise, because if you'd like to consider them as a whole, I'll just go on to the timberland applications.
They're all one resolution, so if you want to just give us the report on all of them.
Keith Smith application for timberland. Is a 19.3-acre parcel. The timber management plan submitted was an excellent plan. It received a score of 14, which is consistent with a recommendation of staff approval. This application was a transfer from designated forest land. It was at one time part of a larger tract of land, and since it fell below the 20-acre minimum for designated forest land, the application... is applied to reclassify. Staff recommends approval. The Kennedy application is a 9.5-acre parcel. This is an application for timberland. There are 6.7 acres of timber that is addressed in the timber management plan. I should say that of the three applications, the Kennedy application and the Sefton application, Planning Commission recommendations were to deny. Staff recommendations are approval based on the criteria and scores that are consistent with the staff recommendation of approval. Any questions?
Councilmember Mann, clarifying question?
Yeah, clarifying question. I think it is important to make sure we know what our Planning Commission recommended on these, and I didn't hear you mention what it was on the first two. So could you just
certainly
give us the Planning Commission recommendation on each one and the staff recommendation on each one again?
On the application for open space land, which is a transfer from farm and agricultural land, it's a 11.78-acre parcel.
Just the recommendations.
It's a Planning Commission recommended denial on the Sefton application. The Planning Commission recommended denial or approval on the Smith application, which is an application for timberland, and the Planning Commission recommended denial on the application for timberland submitted by Mr. Kennedy.
Okay, thank
Madam
Chair. Councilmember Kremen.
Thank you. Are you at liberty or do you have the ability to divulge what the vote was for the denial on, I believe, the Kennedy?
I do not. I believe that it was a straw vote, and I don't remember who actually voted for what. I do know that there was a motion to approve, and the motion failed.
The council received an email that indicated that it was a split vote.
It was not unanimous to deny. It just didn't. It failed to reach a majority to approve.
And the other two, was there a split vote on the other two?
It was not unanimous. I believe that the Smith application was unanimous. I believe that it was not a unanimous vote to deny on the Sefton application.
Thank you.
And thank you for bringing that up, Councilmember Kremen. It would be, if the planning staff could note that the council would like to have the Planning Commission's actual votes for recommendation in the record, and so that we'll know what happened.
Okay.
Thank you. Councilmember Brenner?
I wasn't going to bring this up at this time, but since you both did, I think it's important how complete our minutes are. No reflection on you at all. I think our staff should be doing those kinds of minutes because we're not getting real complete minutes. We talked about this at budget last year, mm-hmm. and so I want to bring it up.
Maybe you can bring it up in other business
Thank
tonight.
You. Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you very much.
All right, so I'll start the public hearing, and I've got a list. It looks like William Kennedy is signed up first. Is that you, sir? Oh, okay, come on up. And then it'll be Ellen Thompson, Royal Sefton, Sue Sefton, and we'll go from there.
Good evening. I'm William Kennedy. And
can you pull the microphone up? It's
okay.
There you go.
William Kennedy. I'm a resident of Maple Falls, and I submitted an application
for... You can't hear it all. Is there a way you could lean into that a little bit?
Submitted an application for a... timberland designation of 6.7 acres of my 9.5-acre parcel. If you look at the review process that's put together by the Planning Commission's staff, they have a checklist which they go down, which exactly parallels the code requirements. I forget the code section, but I wrote an extensive paper, about a 4-page paper, and emailed it to all of you. I only have 3 minutes, so I just want to urge you to please read it before you take your vote. I was under the impression it was meeting all the requirements. The staff gave it a perfect score. Staff actually went out and walked the property and did an on-site review. And then when it came before the Planning Commission, I was not at the meeting, but I did listen to the audio of it. It seemed like it was progressing nicely, and then they took a vote, and somehow it went off the track, so to speak. And it just got denied. So I believe I meet all the requirements. I'd really like to see this thing approved. I do urge you, pretty much everything I had to say was in my letter, and also the certified forester, arborist, who helped me prepare the report and plant the trees and whatnot. He also issued an email to you folks, a short one. Later. In fact, I think he's going to speak also tonight. So unless you have any questions, I just ask you to, please give it a fair review, and I'll be happy. Okay?
Thank you. All right, Ellen Thompson.
My name's Ellen Thompson.
Hang on just a second, Ellen. One of the things I didn't do is I didn't let people know. When you come up, you need to speak into the microphone, and those things move, so you can put it up right where your mouth is. State your name. State your name for the record. Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
And you'll have 3 minutes to address the council. You'll get a 30-second warning when you've got 30 seconds left.
Thank you. My name is Ellen Thompson. I am the president of the Whatcom Association of Celestial Observers, which is Whatcom County's local astronomy club. And I'm here to speak in support of the Sefton.
You're fine.
Their bid for open space change, a reclassification of their land to open space. They've offered the site to the club as a place where we can hold our star parties and our public outreach programs. And for a few years now, we've had a lot of trouble finding a dark sky site in Whatcom County that was accessible to everybody. And right now, we've been going up to a clear cut on the Van Zandt Dyke in the wintertime and up to Artist Point, the parking lot at Artist Point, in the summertime. Neither one are really totally acceptable to a lot of people in Bellingham because of distance. And we all know the dangers of going up onto logging roads in the dark at any time of the year, but especially in the fall and winter and spring. So having a site that's lower down and very accessible and easy to get to would be wonderful. We have our current outreach programs reach about 800 people a year, and we're part of the Night Sky Network, NASA's Night Sky Network. And anyway, I would just like to speak in support of this, having this piece of property available as a possible dark sky park in Whatcom County. Oh, also, we get a number of requests every year from people who are looking for places where they can go safely and legally after dark to look at things like just the stars or the Perseid meteor showers in the summer or the Northern Lights. And there is very little space in Whatcom County where you can do this. Most parks close at dark. And any place like a public parking lot or a church or a school, the parking lots are too well lit in order to be able to see the stars. So this would be a great boon to astronomy in Whatcom County if we could have access to this land. So that's what I have to say tonight. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. All right, Royal Sefton, Sue Sefton, Aubrey Stargo, and Chris Halterman.
Good evening. My name is Royal Sefton. My wife and I own the property in question on Goodwin Road. We have 11.78 acres. The property is 450 feet wide, which fronts on Goodwin Road. It's 1,170 feet deep. The only development on the property is up by the Goodwin Road end. It's actually partially forested. It's excellent property for the astronomy club. We've also talked to, my wife has done a lot of the legwork on this. She's talked to people from a jogging club, because we have trails that are mowed through the trees and down through the pasture and such. The land is not really suitable for agricultural purposes because the soil, 85% is deemed unsuitable for agriculture. and part of it's forested. We are not growing trees for harvest. It originally had been a Christmas tree farm, but it was let go to seed, basically, for several years before we purchased the property. Anyway, we would like to offer this property to people like the Astronomy Club, plus the Boy Scouts, and other groups that need a place where they can go out and commune with nature, study the stars. Our property to the north is open, so northern lights are highly visible from our property because we can see all the way into the Canadian Rockies. And there's adequate parking for buses, cars, whatever. The land is extremely hard because it's basically a gravel pit. So we have no problems with drainage, so there's no soft spots for parking. We've had the fire department park on our land when they were doing a controlled burn across the road on the other side of Goodwin. They were in there four times doing that because they burned two houses. We have no problem allowing people to come in and do things. If they're going to do night things, the only thing we request is prior permission so we know they're coming. So somebody doesn't show up at 2 o'clock in the morning and go out there and stargaze, and we're wondering who showed up at 2 o'clock in the morning. But we've owned the property for 12 years. And like I say, we mow trails through there. I've got a large riding mower to use, and we recently sold our tractor because we're not doing any land clearing. And potentially I'm going to have to buy a bigger mower if I'm going to start doing a lot of stuff for the Astronomy Club. But that's what it's there for, and that's what we'd like to see the land used for. So is there any questions I can answer for you? One thing I didn't talk about is the Planning Commission meeting. They did a voice vote, and I thought we won. I thought it was in favor of acceptance, and then I was told it wasn't. I never saw a straw vote where we could see who voted which way. So I was kind of surprised at that because of the staff
30 seconds, please.
Councilmember Brenner, you've got a clarifying question?
Yeah, I have a clarifying question.
Sure.
You said when you bought it, the tree farm stuff was going to seed, and
basically, we got the history of the land is the guy that originally owned it died.
I just want to know when you bought it.
We bought it in 2002.
Yeah.
The trees were there. We looked at them, thought there was marketable Christmas trees. They weren't. They'd been let go so long. They were just planted too close together. They'd never been thinned. They were oversized, and there was nothing marketable for Christmas trees. And now they're too small for timber. Eventually, it'll be timber. But at this point, it's just scraggly fir trees.
Okay. Thanks.
Other questions?
All right. Thank you.
Okay. I'll yield to my wife. She has more information on the property.
This must be Sue. Okay.
Sue Sefton. I'm a little shorter. My husband and I had surgeries on our hands. He's just so you know. The jogging club is actually the Trailblazers and the Girls on the Run through the YMCA. And Jan Gallant, she was featured in the Whatcom magazine. It's for fall of this year. As an up-and-coming person, she's been in many marathons, half marathons, and whatnot. So she is very involved. She has other groups that she has taken care of too. There's a letter in there that explains it in depth, the one with the trees on on the letter. It's basically her programs are to boost self-esteem in young people. And Trailblazers incorporates a summer camp with boys too. And it's a very educational program, and we feel it would be a good thing for them to be able to come out. And she loves trails, Jen does, and so it's a good thing for the kids to learn from her. The Astronomy Club, I'm very excited about doing some astronomy. I have wanted to for a while. But when I contacted them, they were very, very enthusiastic. Jen was too, as you can see. I put the email in that, also in that letter. There were some other things. And I contacted a pony club, but they didn't get back to me. And that's on there also. I had to do this last minute because of our surgeries, or actually mine. I have to have both done. So I apologize for the lack of contacts. But the people I've spoken to, which I don't have on paper, have also been enthusiastic. We are the only application for open space recreation and open to the public, public access, sorry. And I was checking around, and nobody has anywhere to go for some things. They have to go to a park. Parks are out of the way. We're right in the center. We're 30 minutes to Bellingham, or excuse me, 30 minutes to Ferndale, about a half hour also, 20 minutes to a half hour from Bellingham and Linden. So it's very convenient. We do not want to have the trees taken off that land.
30 seconds, please.
And we definitely have, you know, we could log it if we didn't get this access, and I don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. We've got to preserve. I mean, everybody's into preserving now, and I think that's very important. Questions for me? Is that it all?
If you're finished,
okay.
If you're finished, you're finished.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank
you. Thanks, Sue. Aubrey and Chris Halterman.
Good evening, council members. I'm Aubrey Stargill, a forester and certified arborist, and I'm here to speak in support of the Kennedy Open Space Timber application. I did draft the timber management plan for Mr. Kennedy. As you've heard, it was denied by Planning Commission in spite of receiving the maximum number of points possible for the application and having a staff recommendation to approve. The application met all the requirements of the law but was denied by the Planning Commission based on what I thought were vague feelings and an apparent dislike of the law, RCW 8434, which provides for these open space applications. I don't believe the application should be rejected on an arbitrary basis based on somebody's feelings or dislike of the law. The app is it completely meets the requirements of the law. Mr. Kennedy has diligently implemented the plan. He's planted the trees, and he's seeing to them, making sure that they're growing successfully, et cetera. So in short, the app should be approved. Growing trees benefits all the Whatcom County residents, and we ought to support it. But I guess the biggest thing that bothered me, there wasn't a good reason for denial of the application other than somebody didn't have a good feeling about it. So I'd be happy to answer any questions. You should be in receipt of an email that I sent.
Mm-hmm. Any questions for Mr. Starko? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Chris Halterman. No, pass, wrong sheet. Okay. Does anybody else wish to speak to the council on this public hearing for open space applications? All right, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. And what are the wishes of the council?
Move approval.
All three.
Councilmember Knudsen is moving approval of all three. Any discussion on that? Councilmember Mann?
I'll support that. I just want to thank the Seftons for what seems like a great property and the outreach that you did to make sure people are able to enjoy it. A lot of times these properties get into the program and then the owners do their best to hide them. So thank you very much for your efforts.
Councilmember Brenner?
I move to amend to remove the open space application one.
Which one is that?
The open space, not the open space timber. Open space.
Okay.
And I want to speak to it. Sounds very nice what they're doing. It's in ag, open space. It has been for years. And, to me, this absolutely flies in the face with what we want to do about ag land. There are so many pretty places out there, and it really, I'm sure it sounds like a beautiful place. It's surrounded on most sides by ag. I really am concerned about sticking another very public intensive use in the middle of some ag land, and I feel that right away, we're going to start getting complaints about usual and accustomed ag practices. And I feel bad for the Sextons, but Seftons? Is that right? Sorry. Seftons. And it's, this is not something that I don't want to see us be putting stuff off the tax rolls because it's beautiful, because three-quarters of Whatcom County would fit that bill. I'm really concerned about where it is, and I'm also really concerned about going from ag to open space. That ag is, we've said ag is so much, so important, and I just feel like they can still work with the astronomy people, and they, I mean, if I was them, I would work with the woman who spoke and have her come out with her people. I think it would be beautiful. I just feel that I think that we are really supposed to be prioritizing on open space applications, and they could, you know, I know why they want to change from ag. They don't want to do a Christmas tree farm, but there are other types of ag they could do, and I really believe that by this kind of change, it's encroaching into ag, and it's so strange that we're all smiling and saying yes on something like this, and it's nothing to the applicant. I feel like I did look at some of these things, you know, about benefits and all this stuff, and to me, the benefits they said are going to be provided would be provided pretty much anyway, except for the public access, like helping natural resources, retaining, not doing more development, because any kind of really intensive, like, residential development, it's the ag land. You can't develop it anymore, I don't believe, because it's less than 40 acres. I know they could put up some ag-related buildings, but I just feel like it's not as high a priority as the ag is. And, you know, it's been in ag. It's been in ag open space. They are getting a benefit. I think we could have people be more creative about making ag work if we don't let them opt out of ag with a benefit that it has because they want to, you know, do something else. And I'm sorry, I just have a real hard time with that one.
So. Councilmember Weimer?
Well, I'm going to speak against the amendment because I support the Sefton application. And for three main reasons. One is that we've been doing this for years, and I think it's unfair to just because, and I think we all have discomfort with some of these open space applications and want to change the rating system. We can't change the state law, but it's kind of unfair to change the rules in the middle of after people have applied for something and come forward in good faith. So that's one reason. The other reason is, and it says right on our application, this particular site is 87.6% not prime ag soils. And as the applicant said, a lot of it has already been mined for gravel, so it hasn't left very much prime soil. So those are the two main reasons. And the other one is leaving it in open space doesn't preclude the idea of it coming back into ag at some point in the future. It's not like you're precluding that. So I speak against the amendment. We'll vote no.
Councilmember Brenner?
That was an issue I wanted to mention. I forgot. Thank you for reminding me. I have a very hard time believing that it's not productive soils there. I can't even believe it. First of all, your best gravel pits are below ag, below farming. And that's why we have such a hard time siting them. That whole thing about having gravel underneath soil is what helps it to drain and what helps the soil enrich, you know, the whole thing is enriched by it. The fact that you've got great trees growing on it, I mean, that you don't have to have great soils, but it's way more than just gravel sitting there. It's good soil. Well, good enough. There's a whole lot of ag right in that area.
So I'm going to speak to this a bit. This afternoon we had quite a long committee discussion meeting regarding the whole open space process. And one of the things that we discussed was that the criteria that we're using in the county is 24 years old. And so at the end of all of this, I'm going to make a motion that we immediately start a revise on our criteria because it isn't fair to the people who are paying an application fee and going through the process to get into the process and then find out that even though the planning department staff has rated their application high enough to pass through the program, because of so many changes in the last 24 years, priorities have changed and shifted. But the applicants shouldn't be the ones that pay the price for that. So I'm going to speak against the motion. I'm going to support Councilmember Knutzen's motion. And Councilmember Brenner, do you have something to say about that? I'm sure. Okay.
I think we should work with the administration and waive the fee. I think they should get their fee back if they were if they felt, you know, they didn't have good information and stuff. I don't believe that just because the code is the way it is, that it makes it. We wouldn't be here discussing it if we had to, if it was just what things are, because I did look at all the, parameters, and there's a whole lot of discretion in what we do. I would be fine with, you know, making sure they get their application money back. I just don't think this is good to stick it in the middle of people who are farming. That's all.
Well, and I'll just say that I can't agree with you more about this program. I think that it's grown way outside of the bounds that it had originally been intended for, and that's why I'm really interested in having us revise the process that we use. But I don't want to do it on the backs of people who are in the middle of the program. We should, you know, I know last year when we were discussing this, the Planning Commission alerted us to the fact that these criteria were old, and we should have taken action then to get the criteria revised so we weren't sitting here a year later with the same issues. Any further discussion on the motion to amend, Council? I mean, Dana?
I just want to clarify for the record, it's a little bit confusing in this language. Can you just specify for me which three you're moving for approval? Because the language down here talks about denial, Planning Commission recommendation.
There's only three. Correct.
So if we are to move to approve the resolution, then we're moving to deny the two and approve one as written. So the motion was to move to approve all three of them.
Right.
So we would be.
Is that
do we
clear?
Need to?
Yeah.
Do we need to make a motion to amend?
I think that motion will be fine, and then we'll just take the resolution and amend, make it correct tomorrow before we.
If it passes.
Yes.
Okay.
Correct. Thank you.
All right. So any more discussion on Councilmember Brenner's motion to amend? All right. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
All right. That motion fails 6-1. Councilmember Brenner opposed. All right. So we have a motion on the table to approve all three. Any other amendments? All right. See any other discussion? Seeing none, this is a resolution. And we just vote. So all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
All right. That motion passes 6-1 with Councilmember Brenner opposed.
But I did support the timber ones.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. And we'll move into our second public hearing, which I have a suspicion is why we have a packed house tonight. And we will be talking...
Well, if we've had a more packed than this.
Well, it's kind of halfway packed for a beautiful, almost sunny day. We've got the ordinance adopting amendments to the Whatcom County Code to allow packing houses in the agricultural zoning district. And I'll ask Josh to come up and give a staff report on the current situation.
Good evening. Joshua Fleischman, Whatcom County Planning and Development. I just kind of wanted to go over the changes from the last proposed ordinance, changes that were made at the last meeting. The highlights were changing the size of accessory use from 10,000 to 7,000, changing the size of the conditional use facilities from between 10 and 30,000 to 7 and 20,000. This would require that facilities with the state waste discharge permits have adequate storage for their waste. There was a requirement in here that 75% of the animals processed come from Whatcom and Skagit County. That was amended to include Island County. Another change was on the holding pens, limiting to them necessary for processing within 24 hours. And then there was some language in regards to mailing to neighbors within 1,000 feet that states that the notice shall be mailed by Planning and Development Services, explaining that an application is being processed for a packing house on the subject property as an allowed use and that the notice is being provided as a courtesy only. A copy of Whatcom County Code 2040-114 would be provided with a notice.
Okay, any questions for Josh before we start?
Can I ask my question?
Wait. What's your question?
Frequently
Okay. Okay, so thanks, Josh. Don't go too far, though. But we'll open the public hearing, and we'll start with Matt Petrini, Charles Law, Ken Calhier. If you want to go ahead and start lining up, Tip Johnson and Rana Loesch.
There we go. Hey, guys. My name is Matt Petrini. I work for Resources for Sustainable Communities. We're a local conservation nonprofit. We're also a building supplier. And I'm here to talk to you tonight about the Solar House Ordinance. I spoke to you before about some of the concerns about water quality. We appreciate some of the changes that have been made. We think it's sensible to source 75% of the livestock from Whatcom, Skagit, and Island counties. We think it's reasonable to reduce the size of the proposed slaughterhouse facilities and to specify what immediate means in terms of eliminating the need for feedlots. All of these things make a lot of sense. So we really like to thank you for that and making those changes and support them. The other thing, speaking more generally about the ordinance, we're not too far from an ordinance that we can get behind, that the ag community meets their needs. It's not an impossible thing here, and I would really encourage you to continue to look at it and figure out a way that we can protect water quality. That's a concern that a lot of our 10,000 members have about this particular ordinance. There was some discussion last time about whether or not all the waste from these facilities would go to anaerobic digesters. If it did, you know, that would be a possible solution to some of those problems. It's not necessarily required under state law that every facility that's built would go to anaerobic digesters. So, you know, we could put that requirement into the ordinance, and that would help in a lot of ways. We could remove the particular wetlands and aquifer recharge areas where they might be susceptible to water quality contamination. So there's a lot of possible solutions here that would still expand the amount of land available to produce livestock and value-added products, which is something we think is important for our local agricultural community, and also meet the needs of our community in terms of having water and soil for the future. So I encourage you to keep working on that, and hopefully tonight you can make some changes that will make that possible. And we're happy to speak with you at any time about any of this. So thanks a lot for accepting our comments and for considering many of the issues important to people in Whatcom County and for all the work you've done over the past year or so on this ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Mr. Law.
Good evening, Charles Law. I'm not going to try to persuade you to change your minds. Your mind's already made up. I just want to make this take this time to make a statement in regards to the human condition. I would like to read to you from the thoughts from William Tuttle, the author of World Peace Diet. Dr. Tuttle spoke on the question of relationship between human beings and agricultural animals, and came up with some interesting interactions. Did you know that ag animals eat more fish than humans? Of course, cows are supposed to eat grain. But more important to me, coming from a background of domestic violence, which was prevalent, did you know that there is a correlation between domestic violence and slaughterhouse workers? It is common that when a slaughterhouse workers are working at their jobs, when they are constantly killing animals and slaughtering and murdering, they become completely desensitized to the violence. and they go home and they create violence in the home situation. Not because they're desensitized, but because they don't have any other outlet to express their frustrations. So if you care about the human condition, slaughterhouse workers really affects not only animals, but also human beings. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. We've got Ken Collier.
My name is Ken Collier. I live in the county just outside the Bellingham city limits. Thank you for providing this opportunity for citizen input to the council's proceedings. I'm providing copies of a letter to the editor published in the September 4th issue of the Cascadia Weekly. I expect you have all read it already, but in case you haven't, the writer provides a clear, logical, and eloquent criticism of the slaughterhouse ordinance currently before this council. She explains how the ordinance in its current form does not serve the needs of all our local farmers, local consumers, or the community as a whole. It does not protect a diversified farm network, and it certainly does not protect our water resources, already straining to meet a complex range of competing demands. From what I have been able to learn about this proposal, it could permit the creation of an unlimited number of industrial slaughterhouses constructed without notice or public hearings or any regard for the impacts on other properties. These factories could process product from all around the Northwest, from Canada and beyond, spilling effluents into our water supplies and driving families now farming here out of the county. Our elected officials say they want to support farmers, but this proposal seems rather to threaten them and their lands. Why has there been no needs assessment? How can there possibly have been no requirement for a SEPA environmental impact statement, given the immense impacts these facilities would wreak on waste management and water quality and quantity? Will this ordinance encourage more livestock production than the county's infrastructure can handle? Who are the proponents of this ordinance, and what are their real motives? I suspect the issue of property rights might be involved. If property rights means being able to trash the community with no concern for one's neighbors, their water quality, their air quality, their livelihood, or their quality of life, then I think the term should be redefined. Please withhold action on this ordinance until there has been resolution of several serious issues involving a realistic needs assessment, numbers of facilities, protection of water resources, adjudication of tribal senior water rights, wastewater management, impacts on existing farmlands, the need for a SEPA EIS, and the requirements of the Growth Management Act, which has been state law for 23 years. And in your deliberations, please pay utmost attention to the interests of all our local farmers and all county residents. In particular, please protect our precious water and other natural resources. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Tip Johnson, 2719 Donovan. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I appreciate that you've tried, but you can't fix this ordinance. I'd like to draw your attention to the USDA publication Slaughter and Processing Options and Issues for Locally Sourced Meats, where they explain that market demand is based on, quote, consumer interest in how meat is produced, how animals are slaughtered, and the particular diet fed to livestock, end quote. So far, the council has contemplated no standards for quality or treatment. The statement also tells us exactly how it should be done. How's that? Well, producers should partner with consumers and retailers, establish quality standards that can command a premium brand, aggregate production that can support a facility, do a needs assessment, as was mentioned, work with local government for siting and financial support, and find the very best place for one adequate facility. Where this has been done, these turn out to be 3,000 to 5,000 square feet and often serve more than one county. You definitely don't need 88,000 acres of it. Too many facilities work against the aims of this ordinance. Small facilities can't achieve economies of scale, and they tend to be marginal. Consolidation of marginal facilities is the very reason for the lack of adequate infrastructure today. Do what others do instead. Vote this one down and do what Island Grown Meats on Martha's Vineyard did, or Pride of Vermont, or Curry County Gold Beach, Oregon, or, as described in this first USD analysis I already mentioned, or Food and Water Watch's Where's the Local Beef, or the Dunlop Co-op in Connecticut with 55 members that have increased their revenues by $850,000 annually. There are plenty of resources available to indicate that the approach we're taking is the wrong approach. Why do it wrong? Consumers are not going to support brands that pollute streams and critical areas. Consumers will not support brands that impose noisome impacts on the community or brands that don't adhere to humane treatment standards. Consumers are not going to tolerate a shoddy attempt at locally produced meats. Consumers will no sooner do that than voters will support candidates that make them mount a referendum or drag the county back to the hearings board. Quite to the contrary, a community mobilized to overturn bad land use policy will be a great boon to candidates' opponents. I urge you to defeat this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you, Tip. All right, we've got Rona Lorch. Sorry, I think I'm butchering your last name, Rona. Terry Weschler, Keith Smith, and Mike Schoendell.
Good evening. Rona Lurch, Everson. First, you've allowed land speculators to ride roughshod over the interests of local citizens and spent tens of thousands of dollars to fight a state law to coddle special interests. Second, you have a jail proposal that is incredibly out of touch with the terms and concepts, with the times and the concepts of restorative justice. Third, you were unwilling to recuse yourself from the proposed coal terminal deliberations so that you could represent the citizens that you serve. Now we have this slaughterhouse ordinance. A guise for a rezone. You mentioned you do not want ag land to turn into open space. How could you possibly want it to turn into industrial space? It's ill-conceived, and hence you've made delay after delay for this. It's not been studied for water use, wastewater. I live in Everson. I don't want to live in an E. coli cesspool out there. I talked with Mr. Ellenboss about this, and I asked, well, why wouldn't all the meat packers in the world want to come to Whatcom County? My goodness. He said, oh, no, they won't be interested. Then I asked, well, why wouldn't every farmer out there want to have a slaughterhouse on his land? Oh, no, they won't be interested. Aha. So the ordinance doesn't have anything about that, just that they won't be interested. Evidence shows, then, that you've received something like 95% comments and signatures against this proposal, with 5% for. So, with all due respect, these four issues, these shenanigans, plus the fact that throughout these processes, you've excluded the public, and certainly competent stakeholders have consciously been excluded from your deliberations. This just all leads me to believe that you're running a racket here with private citizens and private interests as your customers. As a public citizen here living in Whatcom County, just a homeowner, I urge you to defeat this proposal and this ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you, Rona. Terry.
Good evening. My name's Terry Wexler. I'm from Bellingham. I'm not going to summarize my comments. I've submitted so many comments on this issue and have absolutely reached the limits of my knowledge. As tiny as that was, you would have thought I could have written much less than I did, actually. But the more time that goes by, the more I'm learning about water issues. So what I want to talk about tonight is property rights, my property rights. My property rights guaranteed me by the public trust doctrine, the doctrine that came to this country on the Mayflower from Britain in the common law that we adopted from that country Historians are a little fuzzy on where it came, but they know it was there before the Magna Carta. This very old ancient tradition that holds that our governments hold access to water in trust for the people. That includes the right to navigate the waters, to drink water, and to fish in the waters. It doesn't matter where I own property. If there's water there, I have to be mindful of the fact that the public downstream from me may need some of that water. It's your responsibility to protect our water. You're not doing it very well. You're losing lawsuits about water. The Lummi are complaining about their rights to water. And now you're considering an ordinance without ever conducting a SEPA review. I don't know a lot about water. I know a lot about SEPA. I was responsible with another group, with a small group of people, for training over 1,000 people in how to write comments under SEPA. There was a proposal recently for which there were 18,000 substantive comments written in accordance with SEPA. They weren't letters to the editor. They talked about significant adverse impacts, cumulative impacts, reasonably foreseeable future impacts. They were real comments. Ecology was impressed. The Corps of Engineers was really impressed. They said they'd never seen anything like it. I think 75% of those comments came from Whatcom County. This is not the same place it was 2 years ago. People here know a lot about what you're supposed to be doing to protect our environment. And they know a lot more every day about what you're not doing to protect our environment. I strongly encourage you to table this ordinance, because if you don't, the courts will. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Is it Keith Smith? Mike Schoenfeld? Okay. Is there anybody else that wishes to speak to us on the public hearing? Come on up.
Greg Brown, Whatcom County. Wow, the threats are abounding. You guys need to put a fence up here somewhere. I wasn't planning on talking tonight, but the human condition really kind of bothered me. And the human condition is for the survival of more than 10,000. We need to eat. We have, meaning you, the council, have compromised on this issue for 9 months. And the planning commission, I don't know how long the timing is, but the compromise has been phenomenal, what you guys have done to this to put this together. To compromise further basically puts packing houses out, which I truly believe is the goal of the naysayers of this project. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Yeah, Max Perry, Whatcom County. Greg was kind. It's been 20 months that this has been deliberated on by the Planning Commission and the County Council, and then the open hearing folks on it. And most of the open hearing that we hear of the ones that are against packing houses or the slaughterhouses use emotions and fear, saying a slaughterhouse on ag land would contaminate the water or the soil. And if this is truly their concern, then an inspected, regulated packing house would protect contamination. So I urge you to follow the packing, to allow the packing houses on the ag land. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Wendy Harris, speaking in opposition to the proposal. I could speak to you about many points. There's been many points raised by those of us who have been opposing this for a year. And frankly, most of those issues have not been resolved. If anything, facts have occurred that have amplified the problems that we initially raised. But I started thinking about why this topic is so important, why we've had such strong public turnout. And it's because ag is important. It's important to all of us. It's an important part of our lifestyle and our economy up here in Whatcom County. And why do we have such a strong ag economy here? Two things, climate and soil. There's not much we can do to control the climate. Some things, but that's another discussion. But we have the power to protect the soil. And we're not doing that. That is incredibly short-sighted. We should be doing everything in our power to preserve prime ag soil. That's our wealth, and that's our future. We can't give it away. We can't sell it away because we have nothing left. We're looking at a proposal here that states that we should avoid prime ag soil to the extent feasible without any limitation on the number of facilities that can be built. Anyone who's lived here for any length of time knows that it's difficult enough to enforce regulations when they're written firm and tight. You're not going to be able to enforce a regulation that talks about doing things to the extent feasible, and you're kidding yourself if you believe it any other way. Wishy-washy language in a regulation in Whatcom County is meaningless. The justification for this rezone is about the enrichment of farmers. We need to give the farmers an ability to make a profit in order to have an ag community, in order to have a viable agricultural economy in the future. But you know what? We could do everything in our power to make farmers the richest farmers in this nation. And if we don't have that soil, if we don't protect that soil, we have nothing. All we've done is appeased a few people who've gained personally, but our entire community has lost. And that's why people are here. And that's why people who don't have a financial interest in the outcome of this ordinance are showing up. It's easy to get people to show up for ordinances when their money's involved, but it's hard to get people to show up when they don't have their finances on the line. The fact that we've continually come here and spoken to you and spoken out against this tells you there's more at issue here than just the enrichment of farmers. Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy. Next speaker, please.
So you have our letter. We sent it yesterday, and it's let you know that we appreciate some of the changes you made last time. The change reducing the size of the packing houses was a good one, and I appreciate that a lot. And also limiting the holding pen size was very important. I appreciate you listening on that. We remain concerned about a few things. Not surprising. So I'm going to go through those four things very quickly. First off, screening and setbacks. Those things are really important to us. We have some specific text requests changes in our letter, so I won't go into that too deeply. We also think that you should limit impervious surface. For the comments that were meant spoken before about water quality concerns, the more you limit impervious surface, the greater potential to prevent all that runoff. So that's an important thing. But we're most concerned about limiting the packing houses to non-prime ag soils. It's really important. Wendy spoke very forcefully about this particular issue, but it's really important that we protect these soils for the production of food, for growing food from them. And if we allow packing houses to be limited to the extent feasible, it is fluffy language. You're not going to sit up there and pretend it's not, I'm sure. So we would really like, we have some specific language requests in there for you to change that as well. And requiring applicants to obtain a water right. That's our very one of our other very strong concerns, because we have a water issue here in Whatcom County. I hope I'm not surprising you with this. I'm pretty sure you all know about it. And these facilities require a lot of water, especially when they reach a certain size. So we urge you to at least, at the very least, consider these two changes before you adopt this ordinance. We don't think that, as it's written, it would adequately protect farmland and water resources. So we're hoping that tonight you choose not to move forward with this and make the changes that we request in our letter. And I thank you for your ongoing consideration of this issue.
Thank you, Kate. Next speaker, please.
Carol Follett, Bellingham. And I want to thank you also. I was very pleased to hear from Matt Petrini that you've given this reconsideration and you've made a lot of progress on it. You know, you've heard from me, and it's very hard for me to even consider this as a possibility. Dr. Perry was sounding a little critical that it's taken you so long to work on this. But again, as a citizen, I thank you for taking your time. And I do hope that you will listen to the agencies that are asking you to look at the water considerations and the preservation of the soil and the preservation of the land. It is really vital. Dr. Perry also criticized us for coming up here and being emotional. We care. I think you would not want to live in a community where people didn't care about what happens around them and that we all feel part of it. So my understanding of the history of this is that there was a farmer, a meat-making family that wanted to sell their property. Someone else wanted to buy it. That's how this whole thing began. And we're looking at the issue of slaughterhouses, which are neatly termed packing houses. I wrote to you recently about how some of those things start small and grow big. And my concern now, listening to Wendy and the other CEO of FutureWise, is that these regulations that you have are not going to be tight enough to protect us from that kind of massing. So please, table it, look at it again. Even though I am very much opposed to the consumption of meat, and since this issue, I have actually stopped consuming dairy products, and I can tell you if you do a needs assessment as far as people living healthy, strong, happy lives without meat, it's very possible. How much we need this in our community, perhaps we should look at that also. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
David Haggith from Everson. I'm on behalf of the Washington State Dairy Federation. Just like to lend our support to the amendment. Three major reasons. We feel this is supportive of animal agriculture in the county, not just dairy farming. Obviously, it has a knock-on effect for dairy farming, but also for our other livestock farming neighbours. We feel it's strongly supportive of the county economy. At the moment, there are a lot of animals being slaughtered outside the county that we are, in fact, eating here. And we feel that it's very supportive of animal welfare. We have almost 100,000 dairy animals and many other beef and pigs in the county, that there is very little facility in the county to slaughter them. They're having to travel long distances. On days like this, it's high stress for animals, and we feel that it's very supportive of animal welfare to allow a facility in the county where they could be slaughtered. On the issue of water quality, just to put it in perspective, the average 20,000 cow slaughter facility will produce less waste and less concentrated waste than a 200 cow dairy in a year. We have plenty of those in the county, and we so far are doing a good job of managing our waste, and we would expect nothing less from the facility that's proposed. And the last point on the anaerobic digesters, requiring waste to go to an anaerobic digester does not make the waste go away. It can help manage it in certain aspects, but it's still waste when it comes out of the digester. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hello, my name is Nancy Metcalf, and I am a voting Whatcom County resident. I second the sentiments of all those who have spoken with concerns in asking you to halt this ordinance as it stands. I thank you for increasing the percentage of animals that would need to be coming from Whatcom County as opposed to outside counties, but I do ask you to limit the number of facilities that would be allowed within our county, because certainly
more than just a few is quite unreasonable and gives severe risk to our agricultural land and water systems. I also ask that you do initiate water studies. I don't understand where we will come up with the water needed in order to keep these types of facilities working in a sanitary function, as well as the water that will need to go to the coal terminal. So both of those issues are big water issues, and I ask that you consider those things. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Joe McIntyre-Witt, Whatcom County. I was wanting to email you today because I didn't think I was able to come to the meeting. My computer internet went down, so I'm here to share my letter. I think I might be talking about the elephant in the room. I think a lot of details about this or that regarding slaughterhouses or packing production. We need to consider the climate impacts to meat production. We need to consider the water impacts to meat production. I understand we need to feed people. The planet has tripled its population in the last 100 years. We need to consider what we're doing right here, right now, moving forward for our children and our children's future. So I added a couple facts here. I don't know if you guys know, but industrial agriculture contributes 17 to 20% of the total CO2 emissions that are changing our climate. And also, did you know it takes 600 gallons of water to make one hamburger? So when we're talking about producing meat as humanity, we're using a lot of water. And I think if we want our community to be, or our county to be, resilient and sustainable moving forward, we need to be looking at these decisions on a bigger picture, a bigger scale. And so I'm asking if tonight you can table your vote or vote no and see if you can improve the ordinance to include some restrictions on what you're proposing for our county. I feel like every time a decision's made, I went to the Environmental Heroes Dinner as a guest, and Sharon Roy was a recipient of an award, and she has passed away, and her son spoke. And I was deeply moved at how he said she would pour through the binders of information to try to make the right decision. And I feel like you guys have those binders, and some information might be missing. And I want you guys to always, in every decision you make in this county, to consider the climate impacts and the water impacts. And that way, when you go to bed at night, you can go, you know what, I made the right decisions for my children and my children's future and the future of our planet. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, Michelle Smith, Bellingham. I sent you all a letter right after the last hearing, kind of focusing really on, I guess, a different aspect than most people have. I'm a consultant, and I work with the regulated community. I work with stakeholders. I work with regulators. And I know how hard it is to navigate through regulations when they're not written well. So I just want to bring to your attention a few things that I think could use some closer attention. One that I find a little bit confusing is the definition of packing house and slaughterhouse. When I came to the last hearing, there was a lot of discussion about how the Whatcom County farmers are looking to bring meat to the table for Whatcom County consumers. The definition, as I read it, of packing house is really very narrowly focused on cured meats, processed meats, smoked meats, and this entire ordinance is oriented around packing houses. And I suspect that most of the citizens, when they're thinking about wanting to buy local, they're probably thinking more in terms of fresh meats than cured meats. So I would ask that you look at that definition and what are we really trying to achieve with this ordinance if it's passed, and what kind of meat are we trying to get on the table for people, and what kind of meat are the farmers trying to, you know, get to the market. The second one I wanted to draw to your attention is this limitation on building area. There's been a lot of concern expressed around the capacity that would be brought into Whatcom County and whether or not it would be adequate to serve the volume of cattle and other animals, livestock. And then, on the other hand, concerns around the impact on the environment due to the volume of processing that occurred.
And neither one of those concerns really has anything to do with the size of a building. And I'm not very good at estimating, but when I look around these chambers, I'm guessing that these chambers are about 10,000 square feet, give or take. And when you start looking at what's required for a relatively small industrial facility, you have to have some place where customers come in, a reception area, a counter, or something like that. You have to have employee break rooms. You have to have employee restrooms. You're going to have a kill floor. You have to have pretty significant freezer space. You have to have a warehouse for your supplies. You have to have a packaging area. When you start thinking about fitting all that into this little space, what you're potentially creating is you're forcing business owners to make a choice about what they're going to put undercover. And I think what you want is for businesses to be able to operate and make the best choices in order to protect the environment, to meet their regulatory requirements, to protect employees, to provide a safe and healthy work environment, and to be a viable business. Otherwise, you're going to go through all this effort to create this ordinance, and nobody's going to want to have a business here because it's time. Restricting. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hello. My name is Nicole Brown. I live in Acme, Washington. And I want to thank all of you for the changes that you've made. I think there are improvements. I would like to see more improvements. I'm in agreement that while I agree with the statements made about the requirement for an EIS and a water analysis and all of that, I think it's pretty clear from past meetings that we're probably not going to get there tonight. So I want to speak specifically on my concerns. It was really hard for me to come tonight, and last time I actually called people that I know out in the county and asked them to come, and I didn't really do that. I put an email out to some people, and it's been really hard to sit here through this process. We own land. We farm. We feed over 500 people a week. We farm year-round. Where I live in Acme, it's sea level. It's the valley, the South Fork Valley. It's extremely wet. Places where there are cattle grazing in the summertime, there are standing pond water there. There are frequently flooded areas that permeate that area. If you look at a map of the hazardous areas, you'll see that. There are debris flow areas that come down from the mountains. There is shoreline along the Knutzen where we're at the headwaters. My family's well, where my 10-year-old daughter drinks from, is 30 feet deep. And my neighbor's well is 15 feet deep. This is all ag land. I was canning food today. We put our food up year-round. Everything from ketchup to everything, pickles, And I'm sitting there canning, and I'm looking at this food, and I'm thinking, I'm running my water, and I'm thinking, this is not a joke. I'm not being difficult. I support on-farm slaughter. We slaughter our sheep. We have local meat. We buy the cow from our neighbor down the road. I recognize some neighbors here that my husband works with and respects. But why we can't acknowledge that these facilities do have pollution pathways? We're not making that up. There are known pollution pathways, sometimes because of an accident, like a flood or a debris flow that we can't expect. But it happens. Right down Route 9, huge sections of the road get taken out, flowing right through the middle of these fields. And these farmers here that live in that area should recognize that. So why is it so difficult that we can't ask that these areas be protected, like frequently flooded areas? Like wellheads in Acme that supply water to the entire town of Acme. How deep is that well? So, again, the EIS, the water analysis, all of that would have taken care of that. But I encourage conditional use or at least protecting some of these sensitive areas. Other things would be ideal, but this is coming from me of, wanting to be friends with these people and buy meat from them, and I hope we can get to that place. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. Next speaker, please.
Lorraine Newman, Whatcom County. I ask the council to put aside the feelings of dislike for this traditional agricultural practice that have been expressed at the public hearings. The meat producers from our community have stated there is a need in the county for additional support facilities for their businesses. Meat packing is a legal and highly regulated economic activity in our country. We in Whatcom County simply need to create space to be able to provide these types of support services. Then we can pursue the possibility of expanding our buy local markets and keeping our ranchers on our egg lands. So I urge you to vote for this ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Chris Halterman, Whatcom County. I want to apologize for putting my name on the first list. I didn't have my glasses on. I forgot you were having two public hearings tonight. So one thing I wanted to mention, since people brought up global warming, I hope you all of you noticed that there's a 60% growth in the Arctic cap this year. So, you know, it's one of those things that everybody keeps debating, but it is 60% bigger than it was a year ago at the same time. After many months, you have the opportunity to approve a sustaining economic activity. You spent a great deal of time on it, more than many had envisioned that you would. I support this amendment because it gives local farmers another means to bring profitability to their farm. It gives other associated businesses a benefit that will also bring greater profitability to their business, something Whatcom County property owners and Whatcom County business needs. This amendment will benefit and provide a sustaining economic benefit to many Whatcom County residents, and I'd like to close with these thoughts. Slow doesn't have to mean no. Whatcom County is a great place to own farmland if you can farm it. Whatcom County is a great place to do almost anything if it's permitted. And with that, I'd ask you please approve your amendment as proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hello, my name is Richard Reese, a resident of Bellingham. I came in late, so I didn't hear the entire proposal. It's my understanding, though, that the proposal is set to go forward without... how long do I have, by the way?
You have 3 minutes.
3 minutes. My understanding is that the proposal is set to go forward without analysis, evaluation, or study of water quantity and water quality issues, and that one of the assumptions of the council, or at least is my understanding, is that the proposal would actually help farmers stay on the land. And because of the water quality issues, I think that it's exactly the opposite, that there's tremendous threat to unrestrained, evaluated use of water in Whatcom County. We don't know what the pressures of the future will be, and it's important for us to understand what these pressures will be. Municipal pressures. Linden recently kind of woke up and said, oh my goodness, if we give all this water to the coal dust suppression piles, then we won't have enough for our municipality. We better claim ours while we can. So my concern is that there's not been enough thought to think what the water pressures will be and what the quality pressures will be. There's some talk of recycling water that comes out of the slaughterhouse. It doesn't sound too good to me. I mean, no offense, but what's the margin of error on recycling the water that comes out of a slaughterhouse? I have some concern about that. All of that said, Whatcom County is fully functional under the Growth Management Act. And it says in the Growth Management Act that these things need to be paid attention to, that there need to be critical review, study, and protection of critical areas, that the aquifer recharge areas, the wellheads that Nicole spoke of, and that to not do that is to not be in compliance with the Growth Management Act. I've been a business owner for 35 years, and I know that there's certain things you need to do as a business owner, or it costs money, penalties and fees. So non-compliance with the Growth Management Act provides or sets up the situation for things that cost money. One is lawsuits.
30 seconds, please.
And the other are revenue streams that Whatcom County no longer has access to if found to be in non-compliance. And so I'm reading this from RCW 36.7A.340, that the areas of noncompliance and restriction of income would be in the motor vehicle fuel tax and the transportation improvement.
Time.
The rural arterial trust account. Anyway, why spend money that we don't have to? Let's just do the study.
Thank you. Okay, next speaker, please. And if you want to speak in the public hearing, please line up, or I'm going to close the public hearing after the speakers.
Hi, my name is Gary Canales. I just want to make a few comments on this. Everybody's worried about the water quality. Yes, we should be. We all know that Department of Ecology, EPA, is going to take over when it's being constructed. As farmers out in the county, we are under scrutiny all the time by all these agencies. Matter of fact, I have a meeting on the 16th with the head of ecology for the state on the Samish River. The top dog is going to be walking around our farms, checking them out. So, I mean, to worry about this, it's a good thing, but we all know that they're going to be watching us every move we make. I mean, inspections, probably monthly inspections on this. So, I mean, to say that they're just going to go out and pollute the world on these slaughterhouses, they're probably going to be the cleanest thing around. I mean, I'm sure you're not going to have sewer spills like we have in Seattle. I mean, we have that, every month we get floods down there. So, next thing, I've spoke before saying that the amount of animals that are going to be in here, we are not going to be able to support more than one, two slaughterhouses. I mean, there's not going to be a whole bunch of them. There's not enough money in it. I mean, not enough people doing it anymore. Everybody's getting out of it because of regulations and rules. People are just selling their animals, saying, hey, we can't afford to do it anymore. We don't want to do it anymore. So, I mean, the public is scared of it, but it's just, I don't think there's any reason to be scared of it. And the zoning and all that stuff, they're going to have to go into permit to check it out, right? To see where they can put the slaughterhouses. So, I mean, we just can't go pick a spot in the county and start building, correct? I mean, it's going to be all inspected before anything gets done. So I don't see a problem with passing this through right now. After you guys pass this through, ecology and everybody else will check it out and make sure everything else is right. So I urge you guys to vote on it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Jeff Rainey from Acme. There's been a lot of false testimony over the 20 months or whatever we've talked about slaughterhouses or packing houses. I've been my father and I think there's 60-some years we've been in animal agriculture. There's been numerous slaughterhouses all over Whatcom County. I don't think there's been one cleanup on a past or existing slaughterhouse. I haul cattle in the Shank Pack in Stanwood. If you didn't know it, that was a slaughterhouse, you'd think they built furniture or some other manufacturing. There's no smell. It's a beautiful facility. I think they're a great business attribute to the community. I think there's just a lot of false statements, and we need to go forward with this. We need to add value to our cattle in Whatcom County. So, thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Next speaker, please.
I'm Esther Faber. I live in Bellingham. I'm concerned about the number of facilities, and I'm requesting that you table this and change the amendment so that it limits the number of facilities to just a few. That's it.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good evening. Irene Morgan, Everson. I had not intended to speak. I came to support someone else. My husband and I ran Morgan Meats for 20 years out in the county. You need to be concerned about water. You really do. We use a lot. We were a slaughter on the farm facility. We brought the animals into our facility, and we used a lot of water. You lose 50%, at least 45% every time you slaughter a cow, from standing weight to hanging weight. So there's a lot of waste. I have a lot of things I'd like to say, and I hope I remember to say them all. We quit 23 years ago because of the regulations. We were inspected by three separate agencies. state, county, and federal. So there are definite regulations that have to be followed. Our inspector, the state inspector, was almost had a heart attack when we told him we were quitting. He said, "You can't do that." He says, "You're the one I always say for people to go look at. Look at your place. You do a good job." So I and my husband has worked in 3 or 4 slaughterhouses over the years. I agree with the man that just said there's very, very little spills to be to happen because they are regulated. I'm speaking on both sides of the fence here, so I'm probably not going to be friends of either. But I'm a mediator. I will always be a mediator. I understand the concerns of some people who aren't. I think you should be concerned about where the slaughterhouses are located. They should not be in wetlands. They need to be. I think a conditional use permit is very, very appropriate. But I think that it needs to be studied very, very carefully, very, very thoughtfully. And let's see, there was something else I wanted to say. I'm not remembering it right now. I think there is need for a slaughterhouse or two. I think more than that would probably be somebody's going to go broke because, like the man said, when we were in business, there were 6 slaughter on the farm. Now there's 2.
30 seconds, please.
So there is a need. I know people that take their cattle to Snohomish County to get them slaughtered because there's no facilities here for, or at least there aren't appropriate facilities. So I think we do need them. But you need to have some definite regulations on how they're operated and where they are located. Thank you so much.
Thank you.